essentially jump over the chasm without even going ahead and working with some referenceable early customer and so on. So now you have the freedom to go ahead and enter the market the way you want to enter it. And obviously, you know, most of the competition is going to focus on early majority and so on. So that is your opportunity to actually go to people who are typically underserved and, you know, seek out their business. So it's you take a kind of shortcut to marketing and sales. Now, this would only work if you have a good personal referenceability, you have good industry reputation, even though you're a startup, just because, and then you know exactly what the market needs and the product needs. So then you can jump over and go straight to a segment of the market that is going to be less competitive, which is what we did for Opti. Then the competition is not calling on these companies, and you get an opportunity to break in when they are sleeping, you know. So that was the Opti approach, and it worked like a charm. But excellent question. But in general, you know, most entrepreneurs do not know if the market is going to accept the product and all of these things, which is, you know, what Cheeky Chunk and other companies that are launching innovative new products, these people, you know, so most entrepreneurs will have to actually do a lot of customer discovery, a lot of customer validation before they go ahead and get their strategy right and their product positioning right and the pricing right and the customer segment target right and the branding right. All of these things you need to do, right? In order to do all of those things, you're going to have to go through the process of customer discovery, customer validation, and you know, which is what you're going to do with the help of the innovator segment and the early adopter segment. Okay, so today we've got probably one of the key segments which will determine the success or whether you're going to face a lot of challenges in your company, in your startup. And and so that is basically we're going to focus on sales. And it's a pretty broad topic, so I'll tell you what we're going to cover. We're going to cover a lot of material. And okay, so basically, you know, if you go to week 5 on the portal, you will find, you know, the sales presentation section, which will give you some information about stuff. And then if you click on this, you'll see that there are multiple presentations. One is, the first two are from Stanford University, and one is on channel sales, and the other one is on direct sales. And then a very important slide, which we are going to use quite a bit, is called the sales call diamond, which is how do you actually transact the sales call. There is a process that you know, experienced salespeople use, and we are going to learn that sales call process in this particular sales call diamond. And this is extremely critical, because if you don't know this, you will think that sales is a very random, lucky kind of a thing. You're either lucky or unlucky when you make a sale. While once you understand the sales call process, you can be sure as to when you're succeeding, when you're failing, and what you need to do to correct the mistake that you're making during the sales call in real time. Then we're going to go into, B2B selling in detail. And then we are going to do a case study on something that is very typical. And today, you know, I'm just going to explain the case study to you. And then it's a Harvard Business School case study. And then I want you to go ahead and try to apply everything that we have learned in the class today in your assignment, right? So this is a classic situation that happens to every company where you're happily selling product to your customers, and then all of a sudden one day you find that, you know, the competition has come in and they have offered the same product or even a slightly better product than what you have for 20% less. And, you know, if you're making 30% gross margin and you need to slash the price by 20%, you are suddenly going to destroy the profitability of the company, which means that, you know, you will not be able to do run your company anymore because you've lost 66% or 2/3 of the profit of your company. So this is a very common situation, and companies that know how to handle customer requests for discounts, you know, are the only ones that kind of that can succeed in the long run. So I'm going to go through the case study, and then I want all of you to think about it, and we will kind of see how you tackle the case study in real life. Okay. So let's get started. Okay, so this is, I'm just going to go not through the entire presentation, but I'm going to just hit the main slides in this particular presentation about direct sales, okay? And then we will hit the main slides in the presentation on channel sales. So the main thing we will learn in this thing is something called the sales funnel. And then what are the tactics needed to prepare for the sales call? You'll soon find that success in a sales call really is based on preparation. It is based on, anticipating what the customer requests are going to be and needs are going to be, and preparing with all the material before the call. And we're going to learn that. And then we're going to do kind of overview of how you use negotiations, and then how do you handle conflict and so on, and then a little bit of sales management and so on. So that's what we're going to focus on. So, you know, I think the key message here is that, you know, salespeople in general often get a bad name or a bad reputation, and that, you know, they always, you know, figure out a way to kind of push you into buying something that you don't need. And, you know, they are just a con artist. And, you know, they are unsavory people. That is kind of a reputation for salespeople But that is really kind of the salespeople that you might meet in a fish market, because people who are in kind of consumer selling are not focused on a long-term win-win relationship. In business, when you sell, you're not interested in a one-off sale. If your salesman can only do one-off sales, you're not going to be successful as a company. So in business selling, the main focus is to have customers for life, is to figure out how you're going to win the customer's trust so that you basically, can every time you have a product that fits their need, they are going to buy from you rather than buying from somebody else. So, and this is the second bullet is very important, which is if you can't sell, you'll always be a slave to someone who can. So the CEO of any startup needs to be a master salesman. He needs to have mastered the sales process, because he needs to sell to his investors, he needs to sell to his employees, he needs to sell to his strategic accounts, he needs to sell to his employees. So he needs to be a master salesman. And if you can't do that, you will quickly be replaced. So that's why in a lot of startups, which are typically founded by engineers, the founders are replaced by somebody who comes in with a lot of selling capability or sales skills within about, once the early product development is done, and then the board essentially says, look, now we need to move on to kind of the market development stage, and we need to get a professional from in the market development, business development, sales development stage of the market. And, Mr. Founder, we are going to promote you to CTO or chairman of the board, but, you're not going to be running the company and making all the decisions. And this happens, I would almost say that in 80 to maybe even 90% of all startups, it's interesting when I went, but obviously I came in with the marketing and sales background besides being an engineer from IIT and all of those things. And I remember when I went for my IPO roadshow to New York City, some of the investors from Fidelity and State Street and others came to me, and we were, I had a cocktail meeting before the event started, and they said, how long have you been CEO of the company? I said, I've been CEO of Selectica since the day we started. We were two people, and now we are, 600 people. And I'm the CEO for the last 5 years. And they were just shocked that somebody was not swapped out by the board of directors, several times over. So the main thing is, I had become very good at marketing and sales and business development. And that is fundamentally the reason that I could continue to, run the company. Okay, so in direct sales, basically there is a process. The first thing you have to do, and this is a word that is going to become very common for all of you over time. As soon as you start running your company and you go to even raise money, or you have to provide a report to your management, to your board of directors, the first thing they'll say is, how's the sales funnel? And if you say, what's a sales funnel? You know, obviously you're on the way to being swapped out. So basically, like in the sales funnel, it's basically a multi-phase funnel, which slowly goes ahead and zeroes in on customers who are most ready to buy your product and takes them through a process all the way to where they purchase your product. So it always starts off with prospecting by market segment. So, and basically, you know, this is typically done by marketing and business development, this stage of the sales funnel. And marketing, business development, and I would add telesales would probably be the people who operate at this level. And they are basically calling everybody in a particular industry segment or a particular people with a certain customers with a certain profile and saying, hey, we are doing a seminar on the next generation of microprocessors. Are we going to do a seminar on the next, the key requirements to succeed with CRM or, you know, some sort of a webinar. And, you know, hundreds of people will sign up. And these days, online webinars are also possible. Previously, we only used to do seminars at hotel rooms and so on. So I've done seminars in Taipei, in Hong Kong, in Tokyo, in Seoul. So I've done seminars everywhere because I'm prospecting. Because I, you know, and we just send out invitations by mass. And by doing that, hundreds of people come. And out of the hundreds of people that come, we have marketing and sales channel partners who are in this meeting and who are picking up business cards and who are getting these people to fill out some sort of interest form. And based on that, a few of them will then be identified as ready for a demo. So typically from, you know, 100 people who might have come to your webinar, the number of people that want a demo might be around 15 or 20. Out of the people that did a demo, the people that, based on the questions and the responses that they give while the demo is being asked, you find that there are maybe, you know, 8 or 10, 7 or 8 or 50% of the people are ready to really seem to have a need. And then you put your apps engineer or you put your consulting group to go ahead and do a needs analysis for this particular set of 8 or 10 customers. And then based on that needs analysis, you have a discussion to figure out, you know, whether the needs match with the expectations. And based on that, you basically prepare a proposal or a quote. And so you work with your own finance department to come up with a proposal, operations department, and then you you get from the customer a sign-off. And then based on that, you now have a contract discussion started where you provide a proposal quote. And finally, you know, you've gone ahead and sold the contract. And this whole funnel can take as little as 2 weeks, or it might take as much as 2 years. So, you know, I've had situations at Selectica where this funnel would be, you know, as much as 2 years long. So when I sold to Cisco, it took us 2 years to go from prospecting, because Cisco is a huge company. So we had to prospect in all the different departments of Cisco to figure out which department would be the right one and so on. So starting with that, all the way till Cisco actually signed the contract, was a 2-year-long process. Now that is exceedingly long, but you know, that was a mega win, right? It's a multi-million-dollar, multi-year win. In fact, Cisco is still using the product 15 years later, and you know, that was probably something that has cost Cisco almost $25-30 million in maintenance and license fee and services over the last 20 years. So 2 years for a product that lasts 20 years is not bad. On the other hand, you know, for other customers at even at Selectica itself, it was more like a 2-month to 3-month effort where we would go through the entire step. But because we had templates for the proposal, we had templates for the contract, we had templates for needs analysis, we had a standard demo, we did not have to do a custom demo. So when you have all of these things figured out for a particular vertical market, you can go through this pretty rapidly and in a very efficient 2-month period. And these are smaller deals in the $500,000, $1 million range. In general, direct sales does not make much sense for products that that will sell for less than, I would say, $25,000 to $50,000, just because you know this process is time-consuming, lots of effort required, and if you're going to spend, you know, we probably spent more than $250,000 on Cisco before getting the contract, right? So maybe even more. So, if you're going to spend that kind of money in terms of your sales team and all the work that's needed in order to win a deal, which you might also lose, and you typically will lose, you know, in the early days, you lose 80% of these deals. And later on, after you've got a good track record, you might lose, you know, 20% of the deals. So all of those costs have to be factored in, the losses, right? So this sales funnel is extremely important to understand, and you need to prepare and you need to get your sales management to give you this kind of a spreadsheet which documents all the customers by different stages of where they are, so that you can go ahead and yourself make a judgment as to when the deals are going to come in and make a financial projection for your company. So this understanding the sales funnel and using it for internal business management, as well as for trying to figure out, you know, how to speed up and improve each of these segments or sections in the sales funnel with the stronger and stronger sales cooperation and organization. So in this entire process, in the US, we've got this term called quarterback. In India, we've got this term called captain of the cricket team. So this is really a sports analogy. And the quarterback in the US or the captain in India is the sales manager who's calling on the account. And he runs the whole thing. He decides who's the right technical person, who's when to discuss with finance, operations, how to understand, you know, what the need is on the customer side. All of this is done by the salesman, and the salesman is your quarterback or captain for this particular transaction. So one of the key success factors for any sales call is a preparation. So as you can see that, you know, cold calls is a complete no-no. Any call that direct sales makes automatically will cost between, in the US, it'll cost $2,000 to $3,000 just to make a call, between the travel, between the compensation for the sales team, the apps manager, the marketing guy. You know, you're spending typically $2,000 to $3,000 per call. And when you do a cold call, which is you don't know who you're meeting, why you're meeting, that is a complete no-no. And the whole success will depend on your preparation. So when you, these days, because of the internet, and previously, you know, we used to use something called Dun & Bradstreet and so on. But, there are lots and lots of ways to get public data to understand the business and challenges that the customer is facing. So you have to get all of that research done before so that you walk in with understanding of what the customer is facing. Using LinkedIn and so on, you and Facebook and LinkedIn and other social networks between your personal, professional, your contact base, etc. You identify everybody that the person that you're going to meet is connected with, and you map your social networks with their social networks. Then you look for common ground as to what could be interesting, and you then try to get a referral, and you want to get the strongest referral that you can get. And then very important is to enlist executive assistants, secretaries as allies in your sales call. So you'll see that salespeople are always super nice to the secretary, to the executive assistant of the director of engineering, or the purchasing director. They become very, very good friends with these people. They bring flowers for them, chocolates for them. They basically take very good care of these people. As a consequence, they get inside understanding of the personality of the person they're going to meet, right? So these are some of the tactics that have to be done, for every sales call. If you're doing 3 sales calls, for each of them, you have to go ahead and have all of this. And as the founder, entrepreneur, CEO, you have to go ahead and insist on a written presentation from your sales guy about all of this stuff before you let him actually go ahead and call on the salesman, on the customer. A lot of salespeople will, just get super excited and just rush to, meetings, whether they're prepared or not. And you have to go ahead and put your foot down and say, if you don't give me a convincing example, a convincing documentation about how you're prepared for the sales call, we are not going to do the sales call. You're going to postpone the call till you're ready. And, you have to put your foot down on seeing that preparation is done. Key to success in sales is preparation, preparation, preparation. And you have to be the person that enforces the preparation for sales calls. So once you meet the person, now you go through the selling process, and we are going to get into a lot of detail in some future presentation. one question that popped in was how to use the strength of weak ties to get a referral. Kindly elaborate. So basically, strong ties is where you know the person directly. He's a good friend, and you can call him to get an intro. But very often, you know, it'll be a weak tie where he might be an alumni from your college. He might be an employee that used to work in your company that is now working in the other company. So, you know, it's a distant relationship. So, you know, you have to go ahead and reach out to these people and then get from them some sort of an introduction. And you can, you know, send out first an email, and then you can go ahead and follow up with the Facebook message or some other messaging system, and then finally, you know, make a phone call or something. So you basically see weak ties. You have, everybody's got like 10, 20, 30 strong ties, but they might have hundreds of weak ties. And, you know, with unless you leverage your weak ties, to, you won't get a broad enough base of potential prospects that you can get connected to. Okay, so negotiations. So there are some excellent books that have been proposed here. You should add them to your list and of reading material. And but you know, the main thing is that all negotiations start with communication. And once you establish trust, which is what you're doing during communication phase, and relationship has been okay, that hey, we've got enough of a trusting relationship that we are happy to do business with each other. Now you go into this iterative cycle where you extract, you figure out the interests of the customer by asking questions. Then you propose options. Then you discuss the criteria based on which they would select between the different options, and you keep on going, iterating in this loop, on this discussion during the sales call, till you either get a yes or you get a no. If you get a no, that's okay too, because that now has to be factored in as to understand is that, okay, if it's a no, then let's understand if there are any other alternatives. And so when you get your no, basically, this is a interesting slide about, you know, where is this no coming from? So is it a communication problem, which is, I don't know, you know, whether I need this product or whether I've got the budget or whatever, or is it, you know, somewhere where I don't understand, you know, the technology, I don't understand the market, I don't understand. So is it a professional issue, or is it a motivational issue? Is it something where, hey, why should I start this project, you know, right now? Why can't I do it a little bit later? You know, if I do this project, is it going to, you know, cause some risk for me, you know? So, you know, if I do this successfully, this project, will I go ahead and get promoted or whatever? So there are a lot of motivation factors that come in, personal motivation factors that come in, why a project manager or director of engineering or a company may decide not to do a project. Very, very common. This is extremely common. Skill gaps, which is, hey, I've already been, I'm using some other way of doing it, because people are always already solving every problem that they're facing. But, you know, you're walking in with a superior solution, and their attitude is, you know, I don't need to train my people to do this new thing. What if, you know, this is something that we ran into all the time, because we had a state-of-the-art artificial intelligence-based configurator, while everybody else before us had a database lookup. So, you know, essentially the challenge that we always had is, hey, I'm not going to train my employees to become artificial intelligence engineers who will write rules and things like that. I'm not going to be teaching them computer science. So skill gaps is something that often comes in the way. Principles and value clash also is where, hey, I'm not going to buy a Chinese product, or I'm not going to buy, you know, a product because I don't know whether I can trust Indians or Chinese. Like Opti was a company run by Indians and Chinese, right? And we were used to sell in redneck territory, and all white companies run by all whites, or companies run by Japanese, if we try to go and sell a product in Japan. So there used to be culture chasm and generational chasm. All of these chasms were there. Personality differences, and most common is, hey, I don't have the time, money, or authority. So you can see that, you know, there are many, many reasons why somebody, you know, you think you understand the customer has a need, you think your product will solve it, but they are going to have reasons why they don't want to go ahead with the project. And you're going to have to figure out how to overcome each of these resistance issues. So whenever you have these kinds of issues, you have to, you know, figure out how to tackle it. And, you know, whenever somebody attacks you, you've got to diagnose it. If people are, if people have some other kinds of issues, anger or you know, just dislike, you have to diffuse it with humor. You can delay a discussion if things are, if people's are getting very angry about something or the other. Or you can deflect the question. So there are many, many different approaches to interacting with, between the human interaction, that have to be handled, and you have to handle it in different ways depending on how the meeting is going and the personalities of the people that you're seeing. So you know, the reason why sales becomes very difficult is because very rarely do people buy based on you just having the best product. People buy based on a lot of other considerations, and that's what makes sales so difficult, but also so exciting and so important. I think when I gave the Selectica story, I talked about the fact that, you know, in a short period of 3 years, we took the same configuration engine that we had, and where in the beginning stages, we could not even sell it for $25,000, within 12 months, we were selling it for $250,000 license fee. And then we started selling it for $1 million. And then by the third year, we were actually closing deals with a $10 million license fee. So we closed deals at Dell, Samsung, IBM, GE, for Cisco for over $10 million, and for the same product. And really, the key difference, if I had to elaborate, was, of course, a product got more complete, solution became, we had referenceable customers, it became safer, etc. But the main thing is we became very good at handling the sales process. Like, you know, we would prepare for the meeting much better. We would execute the meeting much better. And then we would do a post-meeting analysis every time and generate the learnings and improve for the next time. So we had this process by which of continuous improvement, which made our sales team extremely strong. And the team that we put together between sales and professional services and marketing and engineering, you know, was like a Israeli, tactical, you know, operation. So we were just like unbelievable in our ability to sell. So selling is complex. It's a huge area, and it's something that you know, there are not only these 50 or 100 books, but there are hundreds of books. You know, I've probably read about 3 or 4 of these books, and like Brian Tracy, Zig Ziglar. The Magic of Thinking Big. So I've read a bunch of these books, but the book that I'm recommending for B2B selling is Hope is Not a Strategy. And, you know, but the thing is that, you know, once you get into sales, it's important to start reading books one by one. Just keep reading these books, because every book that you read on selling is going to teach you something new, teach you something new, teach you something new. And over a span of 5-10 years, you're going to become an amazing, you'll have amazing capability to sell and build up sales that get results in fantastic long-term relationship. This is a pretty interesting chart for kind of long tail marketing, in my opinion, and as well as for certain kinds of products. And what has happened is that a whole bunch of new tools have come along which allow you to sell more successfully than in the past. And I'll tell you some very specific case studies that I've been involved with. So with Google, you can bring customers to your website based on search marketing, SEO, targeted ads. So I'll give you a case study here. So I was on the board of a company called AppStream, and AppStream, you know, had some unbelievable technology, similar to Citrix. This is almost about 10 years back. So Citrix was getting started at the same time. AppStream had the same, had some great similar technology, not exactly the same, but similar. But they were regarded as, you know, one of the hot startups based on their technology. And the VCs put in almost $65 million of VC funding into AppStream because of the niche, because of the kind of how successful and amazing this technology was. So, and you know, so basically, like, you know, AppStream hired a whole bunch of sales teams and everything, And sales teams are very expensive. And in a matter of 2 years or 3 years, they ran out of the $65 million. And, you know, because they were looking, once you have a sales team, you need to get $1 million plus deals. And, you know, very hard for startups to break into these $1 million deals. So basically, you know, what happened is that the VCs were ready to shut the company down, shut AppStream down. And then, like, you know, one of the VPs of engineering said, look, we've got $2 million left in the bank. Why don't you give me, I really believe that this is a product, great product. Can you go ahead and give me a chance to build this company, because you've already lost $63 million. And so, you know, we said, okay. I was on the board of directors as an independent director. And you know, so we said, okay. And we fired the CEO. We fired everybody in the company. It was from almost 40 people, took it down to like 6 people. And so what he did was, he just went ahead and bought a few Google keywords for AppStream, and he just went ahead and put his application right on the internet, on his website, where people could download and try it out. And what's amazing is that suddenly a lot of schools, which had like even 500 students, 1,000 students, from small towns all over the U.S., the school administrators started downloading this AppStream app and started using it, and then would call up and say that, hey, we want to license this product for $25,000, which was the list price then. And in the beginning, we were saying, why are schools licensing this product? And it turned out that the reason they were licensing it is because they wanted to use AppStream to have one copy of Microsoft Office, and they did not want to install Office on all the laptops because of piracy and other fears that the students would do. So all of a sudden, we opened up the market for $25,000 licenses, where we could not sell it for $1 million, but we got dozens and dozens of these schools signing up for our product by just using Google SEO. And within, you know, 6 months, we hit $1 million in revenue, and with 6 people, suddenly the company became cash flow positive. And then what happened is that Symantec found that every time somebody licensed AppStream, they also licensed Symantec's you know, security software. And so the Symantec salespeople said, hey, this AppStream is wonderful, because every time somebody buys AppStream, they also buy Symantec for another $25,000. So Symantec formed a partnership, and then they started reselling AppStream. And AppStream said, awesome, because now suddenly they had hundreds of salespeople selling AppStream, and the company just started growing and became very profitable. And then about a year later, Symantec reached out to us and said, hey, we would like to buy you guys out. And boom, like, you know, the VCs found that they could sell the company for $65 million, and essentially where they had to write off their entire investment, they could basically recover all of it. So you can see that, you know, social media can, and actually Google can actually allow you to sell your product to a market which would be uneconomical to sell to with direct sales. But, you know, for products that are in the 5,000, you know, I would say from $5,000 range to $50,000 range, you have to create, you have to be able to leverage Google to an SEO to sell your product. Direct sales just does not work from a cost effectiveness standpoint, because the funnel is too, it just takes too much money and too much time to transact each deal. Facebook is wonderful for viral marketing campaigns and targeted ads. YouTube, of course, to get people to broadcast stories, success stories, etc. LinkedIn, obviously, use it for prospecting, even for recruiting salespeople and so on. Twitter for viral marketing and brand analysis and community to discover needs, improve products, create a buzz. So, and there are a whole bunch of new social media channels that are continuously now entering the market. So this is something that these days entrepreneurs should be very adept at using it. So one of the questions is, in India, many times, to get government bids and large contracts, there is some amount of bribery. In the US, I've seen salespeople give simple gifts to client company employees. What is your experience on the same? I would say that, you know, when you have to do bribery and gifts and all that, you are basically going down the slippery slope of getting corrupted. For example, the day you give even $1 of bribery in the US, that company has pretty much got zero chances of going public, because when you do public, there is a due diligence thing, and you will never ever be able to pass the due diligence test to go public. In fact, in the US now, like, it's got to the point, because of Dodd-Frank and other legislation, the CEO has to sign a document at the end of every tax year which says that, you know, there is nothing illegal done by the company. And the CEO can go to jail if the company has got involved in bribery. So in my opinion, you know, bribery and all that is an absolute no. It's not even worth doing business and trying to be successful by doing bribery, because you're not going to be able to build a sustainable company in the long run. Now, the question is, I've seen salespeople give simple gifts to clients' employees. So basically, the gifts are okay as long as they are above board and they are done in a certain way. So let me explain what that certain way is. So one way that, you know, we used to give gifts is that at the conclusion of, say, the contract, you know, we would take all the people that worked on the contract on both sides, we will take them to a great restaurant and spend a couple of $1,000s on food and drinks and so on. So that's, you know, we used to do that. On the completion of a successful project, we would provide a cross pen, something like this, which has been engraved with the name of the project or something like that. We would do that. One thing that I did, I remember, it was a very nice example, was that, I had an American guy who was trying to sell a product to an Indian woman CIO at Fujitsu Networks. and the name of that CIO was Usha Sekar, Usha. So I told, during the sales process, I told my sales guy that you need to figure out how you're going to differentiate yourself from all the other sales people who are calling on Usha. And I found for him that the very first mantra in the Rig Veda is about Usha. Usha is sunrise. And the very first, Rig Veda is the first book in the Vedas, and the Rig Veda's very first phrase is about Usha and how the sun is going to rise on people's minds, etc. So I went ahead and cut out that phrase, and I asked him to make a nice frame for it, and I said that, you know, after, when you finish the sales presentation, you should go ahead and tell Usha that, you know, you were doing some, you thought her name was kind of unique. You were doing some searches on the internet and you found this and you would like to give her a little gift. And he gave her this gift of a framed mantra or shloka from the Rig Veda about Usha. And guess what? I mean, when you do a gift like that, you know, it has got no monetary value, but it has got insane amount of emotional value. Based on that, you know, she's never going to forget him. And basically, like, you know, as it would happen, she gave him the business. For you know, that was like $1 million order that he managed to get, because he gave a gift, but the gift had so much emotional and relevance to that particular gift that, you know, it achieved creating that relationship between this young American sales guy and this, you know, 50-year-old Indian CIO from India, working at Fujitsu Network, a Japanese company. So you can see that, you know, I believe that gifts are, you know, one very common gift is in the U.S. is to offer tickets to go to Super Bowl or go to kind of the basketball or the baseball fly-off games. You know, a lot of companies have boxes where, you know, they give, a lot of VCs will have boxes at all these matches, and, you know, they give, you know, 10 or 15 passes to their startup companies to invite, you know, kind of senior people to come and watch these games from the boxes. So, you know, that happens. There is no monetary transaction. But what it does is that it gives more face time for people from both sides to get to know each other better. And I think that is fine. So to me, like, you know, that those are the kinds of gifts that I believe are excellent at breaking the ice, cementing the relationship. And, but, you know, to execute a gift properly, you need to have put in some time and thinking into the transaction. In fact, one of the requirements I have is that after every sales call, the last thing I want the salesman to prepare is something that I call the delight factor. So every customer, you know, for every sales call, you know, you'll go through the whole meeting, you know, and, you know, they will find out, you'll ask questions and you'll present the solution. You'll do the demo, whatever it is. And then, you know, people walk away. And my requirement for my sales team was to always prepare something that I call the delight factor. How do you leave the customer delighted at the end of the meeting? And the delight factor could be, you know, preparing a copy of the presentation, a copy of you know, industry reports or whatever, get it properly bound in a document, etc., and hand over those copies, very nicely done. Or you can go ahead and provide everybody with a demo disc or, you know, some other samples, you know, but there needs to be a delight factor that has to be passed on to the customer after every sales call. So it doesn't matter whether it's you know, at what stage the sales call is, but there needs to be an appropriate delight factor. And you know, all of this requires preparation, and but that was a must that I enforced in my companies. Another very, very good point is that, you know, you got to have regional as well as the Western social media, and there is a complement for every US social media tool with the Chinese, and if I put on the right hand side, Indian, right? So there is you know, you have to use the relevant social media to reach the appropriate customers. So one question was, can you recommend books for B2C selling? You know, I would say that, you know, no book kind of pops up in my mind immediately, but I would say that, you know, I would say that if you just do some Google searches, you'll find something that is appropriate to you. And the other thing is, you know, there are so many blogs being written. You should find some gurus who have become, you know, well-known successes in B2C selling in the industry you're going after. And go ahead and become, start following them. So that's what I would recommend. Well, let's see if there's anything else.
Hi, Raj.
Yeah.
Chinmay here.
Yes.
One question, you talked about the seven kinds of resistances to the offers during sales.
Yeah.
So I just want to ask, did your team encounter any of those seven types? And if yes, how did you overcome them?
Okay, let's go to that slide. Oh, this one?
Yeah, this one.
Yeah, I mean, you know, for every issue, there is an answer, right? For example, communication problems. This is very common when we go and talk to people from different ethnic groups. For example, you know, when I would go and talk to Japanese customers, when I would go and talk to Chinese customers in Taiwan, or Korean customers, there used to be a lot of communication problems with them because of culture reasons, language reasons, and so on. And, I would actually slow down the speed at which I'm talking. I would use the simplest word that I can think. And I started using broken English when I talk to them. So whatever they are comfortable with, I'm going to mirror that. I'm going to become like that. So the thing is that you have to solve the problem. You don't have a choice but to solve the problem that the customer that is coming up in the sales call. And for example, motivation factor, what's in it for me? Basically you have to create the vision as to why it would be of benefit to the company. And if the company succeeds, then because of a project that, the project manager does, obviously he's going to succeed. He's going to get some value out of it. So, he would say, but there's so much risk. What if this project fails? And I've got to make an investment of several hundred thousand dollars in order to build this next generation PC or whatever. And you've got to explain to them, why if they don't build it, so the competition is going to take away millions of dollars of business. So the thing is that whatever issue comes up, you have to go ahead and address it. You cannot run away from it. You basically have to solve the problem that comes along. For example, the skill gaps that we talked about. So where the guy says, look, data entry people don't know anything about artificial intelligence. And then you talk about, hey, we've got books and manuals of how to do it. We've got people that we can, we actually started having training courses where these people, they could send a group of people to our company for 2 weeks to get trained. We said we can send our own people to your company. So when they come up, when you identify the problem as a skill gap, you go ahead and look for all the different ways to solve it. So it doesn't matter what the problem is. There is always multiple solutions, and you have to go ahead and find which is the right solution that, is appropriate for this particular customer in this particular situation, and then go ahead and figure out a way to execute that solution.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So we have done direct sales. So now let's go to So I'm going to share. Let's see. Oh, come on. Okay, hang on. I need to download this thing from Dropbox. Let me do that. Okay, so I'm going to go through rather quickly how to distribute your product using channels and partnerships, and then we'll take a 10-minute break. Okay, so basically, like, you know, we talked about direct sales, but if very often there are also ways by which you can get your product out there without hiring direct salespeople. and so here is an example. When you sell cars, you can, you know, sell it exclusively through your own channel, or you can go ahead and sell it through somebody who's a car wholesaler and will sell many different car brands, right? So this is basically a very good chart to explain the many different ways in which your company will connect with salespeople. So connect with the ultimate customers. So we already talked about direct sales, but then another major approach is using a systems integrator. VAR stands for value added reseller. And then you also have retailers, and you can either go directly to the retailer, or you can go to a distributor who will go to a retailer to the ultimate customer. You can also sell online, and you can also sell partnerships. So remember that, you know, direct sales is the most effective, but the most expensive. So it may not be financially viable to do direct sales, but as you can see in the AppStream case, the whole company went broke with direct sales, but ultimately succeeded because we went to online sales. So just by changing the distribution channel, a company that was going to go bankrupt had a successful outcome. So the channel decision is an extremely important decision. So if you look at, remember the Cheeky Chunk case, the first year when he had to only sell 1,000 umbrellas, he went directly to the retailer, but he made no profit because the cost of servicing the retailer and the retailer margin, you know, prevented him from having a business that was going to be successful. So when he scaled up, and it's only because he went online with an e-commerce platform that he succeeded, right? So so basically you can see that the channel decision is a fundamental decision that you're going to take in your sales process. For example, when you go to PCs, Hewlett Packard and everybody else essentially used to sell their product through system integrators, value-added resellers, and retailers, while Dell Computers decided to sell their computers online, and you know, both of them were successful approaches, but you know, Dell became an incredibly successful company using their online approach, while you know, you had companies like Apple that used to initially sell their products only through telephone companies like Verizon and others, decided to start their own shops, Apple stores, to sell to the end customers. So you can see that, you know, channel decision is a dynamic choice that is made and can actually be a key success factor in the decision. But there are a number of factors that come in. So the important thing to realize is that no matter which channel you go through, online, retailer, direct, whatever, all the functions of the sales channel have to still be executed. You've got to do the selling activity. You've got to do the service and support. You've got to do the logistics, and you've got to do the financing. Those four functions, you know, will not change. But who does what, and the distribution of this work between the company and the channel, a partner, changes, right? In direct sales, all of this thing is done by the company. When you go to company, to distributor, to retailer, to the customer, the financing and terms, etc., will be done by the retailer. Some portions of the insurance, taking title, might still have to go to the company. The logistics will obviously be taken care of by the retailer distributor. Service and support may or may not be taken care of by the retailer distributor. Selling activities will largely be done by the retailer or retailer, but you know, there might be some participation by the company in the selling process. So the main difference between the channel, between different channels and direct sales, is that in direct sales, the entire gross margin comes to the company, but they have to carry the cost of their own salespeople. If you have a company that sells to a distributor, who sells to a wholesaler, who sells to a retailer, who sells to a customer, you can see that the manufacturer cost may be $100. He sells it to the distributor for $167, who sells it to the wholesaler for $208, retailer for $245, and consumer finally $306. And you can see that different people are taking different cuts of the margin in order to, you know, be profitable for whatever portion of the job that they're doing in these areas. Besides the distribution channel, you also have partnerships where you basically have the ability to have the partner help you sell the product. So that is like a win-win partnership. And we are going to spend maybe 5-10 minutes on partnerships. So there are basically these four kinds of partners based on revenue, vertical, or based on partners' ability to help you develop your core competency. And if both are low, it's a limited partnership. If both are high, it's a strategic partnership. And then you have earning partners and learning partners. And you can see in different partnerships, there was a time when you know, right now Google is a partner on Android with all the Chinese, cell phone manufacturers, right? So with all the Chinese cell phone manufacturers, Google looks at it as basically, you know, as probably an earning partner, since they're not going to learn much from the Chinese company, but they hope to make some money from the licensing of their software. While if you look at the Chinese partner, they look at Google as somebody that's going to be a strategic partner, because Google is teaching them about how to develop, how to go ahead and have a consumer-friendly smartphone, and they're going to make a lot of money off their partner's help. Okay, so basically, you know, when you have a partnership, you have to fill out a table like this, what the partner can give and what the partner can get, because it's always a two-way relationship. One would be like technology, resources, relationships, reputation, core competency, legal, da-da-da-da-da. All of these things, you got to break it down as to what, who gets what. And basically, you use that in order to, you know, go ahead and keep that partnership healthy by the appropriate give and take. So this is a pretty important thing, which is partners one day can be rivals tomorrow. For example, the CEO of Google used to be on the board of directors of Apple, but once Google developed Android, which would start helping other smartphone manufacturers to compete with the iPhone, the Google board requested Eric Schmidt to get off the board of directors, because now they are rivals in the marketplace for smartphones. For people that go ahead and commit to only one partner can find that, you know, they will fail. But people who became partners with everybody, even they fail. So the main goal is to have principled polygamy. Kind of funny. You know, partners keep on requiring different things, and misaligned expectations, a recipe for regret. For example, Intel and Microsoft have had a relationship that has lasted for almost 30 to 40 years, and you know, both of them had to make sacrifices, but both of them also got huge benefits from each other. And every 6 months or every year, the CEO of Microsoft and the CEO of Intel would get together to be sure that the expectations and the give-gets on both sides were balanced. Okay, so partnerships, I think we have done it very, very quickly, but just to give you at least a framework for thinking about how you're going to think through your partnerships. And we've gone through the channel stuff also pretty quickly, because, you know, we want to at least be aware of, you know, what the channel selection decision is all about in the BMC. So if you look in the BMC, there is channels, and in the channels, this is the decision that you're making, and you need to justify how all of these functions can be done better with your channel decision with the right cost model. So if a manufacturer does online and sells directly to the consumer, he can probably sell it for a 40% markup, which is the gross margin that Chicky Chunk is getting. And the customer can pick it up for $140. But if he goes through the retail channel, through distributors, wholesalers, and so on, customer is going to pay $306. So, these decisions have to be made. Any questions before we take a 5-minute break? Okay, so let's take a break till about for 12 minutes till about 8:45 p.m. and then we will get into actually doing a sales call, and then we'll do some more about we'll go through the case study and so on. Okay, thank you. Okay, are there any questions on direct sales, distribution sales, or distribution channels and partnerships? Okay, then we will get started on okay, so this is, in my opinion, one of the best slides on a summary slides on how a sales call should be executed. And the sales call can be for there's a message from Tai Nagpur. Raj, request you to create a group for a class which you had suggested earlier. Yeah, okay, I'll create a LinkedIn group for our class so that everybody can stay connected with each other and hopefully even sell to each other. Okay, good suggestion. Okay, so basically this, all five steps: relationship, process, value, options, and then economic logic, all five steps need to be executed on every sales call. It doesn't matter whether you are selling a product, you're selling services, whether you're selling your business, or whether you're actually selling equity or doing a capitalization deal. So it doesn't matter what you're selling, you have to go through this five-step process in every sales meeting. And your first question is going to be, how can I do so much in every sales meeting? But the answer is that if you don't, you're not going to be able to have a dependable sales process, or a selling process, in order to take you through the funnel in a way that results in successful transaction at the end. So, the goal is to end up with a contract at the end of the funnel, and that funnel will have at least about three, five, six, even 10 or 15 sales meetings. And in each meeting, you have to go through these five steps. So let me explain what the five steps are. So the first step is establishing trust. So if you don't establish trust in the sales meeting before you get started, it's very difficult to get to the next step where you are going to ask some very personal questions about you know, what the customer's needs are. And if you don't get good answers from the customer, you're not going to be able to communicate the value of what you're trying to promote effectively. And if you can't do that, your negotiation or options will not be based on sound data. And if you can't do that, then you will never be able to come up with the right economic logic for why the customer needs to transact this deal with you. So you'll see that, you know, this five steps need to be done for every call. Now, let's try and understand, you know, what we mean by establishing trust. So basically, if you know, if you remember, if you have ever been involved in a sales meeting, you'll see that, you know, the sales guy will introduce each of the people on both sides. And then, you know, every person will get a few minutes, 30 seconds to a minute or 2 minutes to communicate, you know, their background and so on. And during that phase of communicating, you have to address longevity of relationship, the history of relationship, kind of different kinds of all the elements of the partnership that we have, our ability to understand the problem, and the social contract that we have with the customer. So each person, so if you, let's assume that you have a marketing person, the salesperson, and a technical person who are attending the meeting from the vendor side, and on the other side is the director of engineering and some people from the purchasing department and the quality assurance department. So this is a six-person meeting. So in that six-person meeting, when you're doing the introductions in the beginning, the salespeople person should give a little history of, you know, their relationship over the years, talk a little bit about what kind of things they've done in their partnership, and explain, you know, how well we understand their problem, which is, you know, what it takes for them to be successful, and the social contract that we have with them to be their partner in their project. So the salesperson will do that. The marketing person will really communicate, you know, his experience in the industry, his understanding of, you know, what the needs are for the customer type of companies to be successful, and his own length of experience in the company, in his own company and this particular market segment. So basically, he's establishing his relevance and his value add, and similarly for the technical person. And basically, you know, by doing this, you know, after listening to these 4 or 5 minute introductions, the salesperson is going to summarize and say that, do you guys, you know, feel comfortable discussing your business plans and the future for us? Because, you know, we've been working together for 5 years. We've done at least 4 successful projects, which have resulted in millions of dollars of good business for you guys and allowed you to succeed in the marketplace. And, you know, our engineers and marketing and technical people really are the best. And we are committed to having a win-win relationship. So do you feel comfortable that we can be a good partner for you in this next generation smartphone that you're going to be designing? So, you know, the director of engineering and the purchasing guy will confirm that, yes, we've been working for a long time. We've done 3 successful projects. They all worked out on schedule. And even when there were problems, you guys stepped in and worked to solve the problems in an appropriate way with intelligence and so on. So we feel comfortable discussing with you, our project plan for the next smartphone that we want to design. So this whole thing can take 3 minutes, 5 minutes, 7 minutes, 10 minutes, or it might even take 30 minutes, depending on, how well everybody knows everything and so on. So, but till the salesman has got agreement from the direct of engineering, purchasing manager, and QA guy that, there is a trust between the two companies to, work together to have a win-win relationship, we cannot go to the next process, to the next step, which is the process of deciphering and figuring out the need and scope of their project. So once that trust is established, now the salesman can say, can you tell us how big is this project? What is the price point at which you're going to sell this phone? Are you going to sell it at $300, $500? Is it going to be a premium product, based on a $500, how much money will you be spending for the microprocessor or the communications logic? Who else has the CEO approved this project? Has the marketing group kind of given the go ahead with this? Is this product? Is this product well positioned in your product line? What will be the QA and test requirements? Do you have 9 months to make the decision or 18 months to make the decision? Because, based on how they answer the question, we can propose alternative solutions. So what is the timing? So all of these questions, one after the other, are being asked by the salesman and the marketing person, and the apps person, in order to extract the full scope of the problem that the customer wants addressed, right? So once all of it is done, the salesman will summarize that, okay, so let me tell you what our understanding is, that you need to get a smartphone, next generation smartphone design, which will have, this level of performance, which will have this kind of cost, this kind of weight, this kind of thickness. It needs to be prototype by this particular date. The CPU cost should be within the $32 to $38 range. You need availability of this much. You need to ramp it up by this volume. So he will summarize all of the what he has heard based on what, and the customer said, no. We need to actually get the prototype done by October, which is 5 months from now. It's not 9 months from now. So, okay. So that is then included in the requirements of the thing. Once that is done, now you have to promote the value, which means you have to sell your value proposition, right? So at that point, there are three approaches. You can do solution selling, consultative selling, or value selling. And in solution selling, you can say that, look, we can go ahead and really be your partner for the entire project. We can go ahead and bring in the peripheral chip manufacturers, the LCD screen chip manufacturer. We can pull together the entire solution, and we can go ahead and get you to a prototype in comfortably in 4 months, so that you've got 1 month of time to validate everything. So, you can do solution selling, or you can do consultative selling, where you can say that, look, the marketing guy can pitch in and say that, look, I have been studying this market for the last 2 years, and I know that some of the big companies are going to launch a product which is going to have 3x the performance that you have right now, and that will require a custom circuitry that has to be designed in, and that is going to increase the cost of this particular device by 30%. So your price point on this needs to be a little bit higher, because that is what the competition is going to launch. So you can so instead of spending $500,000 on getting this project done, I'm recommending that, you know, you consider spending $2 million on getting this project done, because, you know, based on my understanding of the opportunity in this marketplace, so you become a consultant based on your expertise in this marketplace. So that's consultative selling. And then you've got value selling, where you can say that, you know, where you basically promote the value of your solution by saying that, you know, our microprocessors and our chips are based on this new process technology, and based on that process technology, you know, we are getting this kind of a yield, and this yield allows us to have a cost reduction path that will bring the cost down by the time you ramp up your production to something that is less than any competitor, and you basically sell the value of them using your product compared to the competition's product. You also sell the message that it's not about price, it's about seeing that there is success of the project, and the success of the project is independent of the price that they pay for your particular piece of the project. You know, so you have to be able to communicate there, and you have to respond to whatever their view or perception is. So if that is a company that is always participating in the commodity end of the smartphone business, then you have to sell according to, you know, what is appropriate to there. So when somebody is a commodity smartphone vendor, they don't want to design in a product where availability or scalability of the business or cost structure, fundamental cost structure for the manufacturer vendor is so high that they can never ever bring the price down if the competition increases and the price drops for smartphones dramatically. So you have to sell according to the perception of the customer that you're calling on. If he's a commodity kind of guy, you can't say that, you know, you're going to get the highest performance and this and that and so on, when they don't think that is not a part of their worldview. So all of this you can do only if they gave you the right answers in the beginning, and they'll give you the right answers in the process phase if you successfully establish trust. So once you've done all of that, you go to options, which is you start negotiating. So BATNA actually means the walkaway price. So for every product, there are three prices which we learn in negotiations, which is the opening price, target price, and walk price. So BATNA is the walk price, and they have a walk price, you have a walk price, and you know, you have to negotiate with them and come up with a price between the walk price for them and you, and your opening price and their opening price. So you basically have your negotiation, and we'll talk how to negotiate two classes from now. And then because you went through the three steps prior, which is relationship, process, and value, you know what are the important things that interest them. And, you know, they can't take the position that, you know, the competition's price is this, so that is you've got to be lower than this price. You got to get them to realize that it's it's the success of the project that's more important than the competition's price, right? And it's the value that you bring in through maintainability, support, scalability, economic learning curve over time for manufacturing thing, etc. So brand, all of these things is the reason why they should do business with you. And so you do all of these options discussion in order to come to the agreed game plan. And then you have to go ahead and come up with the economic logic to justify the transaction and put all of that on a piece of paper so that you have this whole meeting documented in the right way so that, you know, in the next meeting, when you start and you're talking about trust, the understanding of the problem is based on reviewing the previous economic logic that you had from the past previous sales meeting, and then you get to the next step. So basically, like, you know, this is like an iteration that goes on sales call after sales call as we go down the sales funnel till finally we get a contracted deal that, you know, results in successful business. So this particular slide, you know, is something that every entrepreneur needs to master. And it's not a question of mastering the words that are there and the bullets that are here. What you need to master is how to interact with people in this style that is appropriate, you know, for your business, for the kind of ethnic group that you might be talking to, and so on. So for example, you know, if we are talking about doing business in India, you know, if a Gujarati is selling to a Maharashtrian, he establishes trust in one way, he figures out how to interact on the process one way, he figures out how to sell in one way, options, all of this is done in one way. If a Gujarati is selling to a Marwadi guy on the other side, he uses the same thing in a different way. If he's selling it to a South Indian, it's a different way. If he's selling it to a North Indian, it's a different way. If he's selling it to a Bengali, it's in a different way. If he's selling it to a Chinese person, it's a different way. So every parameter comes into play, but the process does not change, right? So you might have to change how you interact and how you execute, but the process doesn't change. So, and this will obviously take a lot of practice and preparation before the meeting and a lot of learnings after the meeting. And it's not just you who has to master it, but also everybody who's on the sales call needs to understand this and master it. And over time, your entire team needs to understand this process and make it a part of, you know, how they interact with customers, no matter what. And if you do this, you'll end up with a company who is so good at sales that it'll be unstoppable company. So that's why companies that are regarded as unstoppable in sales and in business are teams which have been trained to execute like this over years and in all kinds of situations. And so that's why it is so important to master this technique. And so we will, and so I would recommend, you know, taking this and then practicing it over and over again in every situation in order to become better and better and better at this whole process. Let's see if there are any questions about the sales diamond. Any questions about sales diamond and how to apply it in your specific sales situations? Anybody has any experience with sales meetings, and do you know what you did right and what you did wrong relevant in relationship to this sales diamond that you've learned today? Does anybody want to share their experience? Okay, I think let's continue because.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Who's this?
It's Vishwas from Pune.
Yes, Vishwas.
So you just wanted to share some thought on the sales process, right?
Yeah, if you've had any experience so that people can see how different people have handled sales meetings differently and what parts of the sales diamond they used or not used.
Yeah, I think the stuff that you mentioned is really, really very nice framework. And the way I would like to relate this to a big sales meeting that you do, you work towards it, you put all your context around it, you work your social media around it, and there is this like key meeting, right, where you've got to get everybody on your side so that the deal can proceed forward, right?
Yep.
And that's the moment of truth in some sense, right? That's where your entire preparation is either going to go bust or is going to get you something. So, the preparation to that kind of a moment of truth discussion is something that I thought, we could think about it in a more constructive way. Many times we just get into a meeting and then find that we haven't done enough preparation. We are just happy to get a meeting and haven't done enough preparation. And then we find that we don't do simple things right. And that actually leads to a lot of damage control and also value destruction as we go forward in the sales process.
Very, very good point. Yeah. That's why, for every sales meeting, you have to go in prepared, probably for 80 to 90% of what you're going to hear. You should be prepared. But there'll always be 10-20% new things that'll come up in your process discussion. Right? So, but 20-30% unexpected things are okay to handle. But if 80% of things are different, then clearly you have a problem on hand from sales management, because it means that your salesperson on the meeting who prepared the call or who orchestrated the call did not do his homework before the meeting. So he did not go ahead and communicate to the team what was the expectation of the customer, what we are going to see, who we are going to meet, who's going to be important, who to pay attention to, what is the customer status situation. All of these things, basically the salesperson should have an ongoing report in his CRM system. And one of the students in our class has launched a new CRM system called UPilot. And I think he talked about it in the last meeting. Today, San is traveling to Dubai, so he couldn't make the meeting. But he's offered to have all our students in this particular class have access to his CRM application, UPilot. And the CRM system should capture most of, you know, the prep that, you know, everybody needs to have before the meeting. So, for example, like, you know, if suddenly the person that walks into the meeting has, turns out that, you know, the director of engineering has been swapped. And now the director of engineering, who used to be a friend of the competitor, was hired in and has just joined the company. And your salesman has not briefed you about the fact that, you know, this person is going to come to the meeting. He's going to be aggressive and he's going to be antagonistic. And, we're going to have a problem in the meeting because this guy knows the competition's products very well. He's decided to pretty much go with the competitor's product, but, you know, he's just asking us to come in. And if the salesperson has not gone ahead and informed the team that this is what's going to happen, then, the team is going to really have a hard time handling the aggressive behavior. This happens, I would say, in a lot of cases, because salespeople have not gone ahead and set up their information channels inside the customer's company properly to know what's going on. And as a consequence, you know, a lot of sales meetings go badly. So Vishwas, these kinds of problems that you talked about are often because the CRM system has not been updated. People did not check the CRM system, did not spend the time to prepare before the meeting. The salesman did not highlight, you know, the main areas to pay attention to. So problems happen from many areas, and, you know, one bad sales meeting can result in, you know, many months or years of work, which will be maybe even totally lost, or it's going to require a tremendous amount of effort to recover from that particular bad sales meeting. I saw a question from Thai Mumbai. How does a new startup establish trust if it's a novel idea? So that's a very good question. And so basically, a new startup, when they come up with a new idea, obviously, since it's a new idea, novel idea, you cannot get trust for something that is new. Trust is based on history of relationship. And, you know, with a new idea, how can you have a history of relationship, right? And you're a new startup. So as I think we went through this in the previous, I think two classes back, where we talked about the fact that the biggest value add for a startup is the people behind the startup. So the people behind the startup have the reputation, either in the technology or in the industry or in the marketplace, or they are a guru, or they've got an advisor who's a guru. So there is a person. The people in the startup have more credibility than the idea or the product. So you have to, during the introduction phase, where you're establishing trust, you talk about this great CTO that you have. So for example, at Selectica, my co-founder was the person who, you know, was a PhD, who had developed all the configuration papers. He had, you know, 8 or 10 of the key configuration technology breakthroughs were his. And so very often, we would walk into our first meeting with a printed copy of his 5 or 10 patents or breakthrough papers, and we would actually hand them out to the team at the beginning of the meeting in order to establish the reputation of our CTO or guru. So we gave that packet of information, the printed copies, to every salesman and said that when you bring in Selectica, you have to first go ahead and use this to establish the credibility and reputation of Selectica and so establish trust. Okay, so trust is established for a new startup based on the reputation of its people rather than the product. Okay, so...
Hey Raj, this is Prashant here from Dai Pune.
Yes.
One quick question. You elaborated upon the different types of selling, right? Social selling and consultative selling and value selling. So could you please elaborate the difference between solution selling and value selling? I did not quite get that. Because solutions sell the value, solutions give the value, right? So how's different? How is it?
Okay. So, you know, for example, you know, Selectica was selling configurators, right? And a configurator used to allow people to configure their routers and switches and everything properly, correct? And, but you know, the customer is not interested in configuration as such. He's interested in selling his switches. Configuration is one step in the entire process of the customer selling the switch. Cisco, when they're selling the switch, configuration is one step. Besides configuration, they have to do pricing. They have to do delivery. They have to do maintenance. They have to provide, how long the project is going to take. So there is a whole solution around the configurator that has to be communicated by Cisco to its customers. So we are selling the configurator to Cisco, right? So when we sell the configurator to Cisco, we will go ahead and talk about the fact that Cisco needs to have this entire solution that they need to sell, that'll help them sell their switch to the customer. And we will talk about how our configurator is seamlessly integrated into the SAP ERP system, is seamlessly integrated into the pricing manager, pricing system at Cisco. It's seamlessly integrated into the CRM system. So basically we talk about how the configurator that we have is a part of a total solution that seamlessly will work in order to help Cisco be more effective in selling, because Cisco is more concerned about effective selling of their switches rather than just the configuration piece. Now, when we come to value selling, we are saying that, you know, our configurator can configure the switches faster, can do it in, you know, 10 seconds, where the competition will take 2 minutes in order to configure. And we can say that, you know, our configurator, the total cost of ownership over a 1 year period is going to be 50% less than the competition's. So you are selling the value of just the configurator, right? So in one case, you are selling the total solution. In the other case, you're just selling your portion, but based on it being, you know, the best offer, best thing possible for the customer to buy, right? So, and you can do this to anything. You can, for any product or service you're selling, you can depending on what you heard during the process phase from the customer, you can decide what is the right way to sell. You know, if the customer already knows how everything else works, then you have to focus on value selling, because he wants something that'll fit in, that'll make it all, you know, that'll be the best thing possible. But you know, if the customer really is getting into doing online selling using a configurator for the first time, then you've got to go and propose solution selling. Because what's the point of selling the value of your configurator if the guy doesn't know how it's all going to work together to help him sell his switch, right? Yeah, okay. But excellent question. So,
hello.
Yeah.
I'm Dr. Vanita Medkar from Belgaum.
Yes.
Hello. I agree with the 5 steps of establishing a business. I'm a doctor by profession.
Yes.
Along with the other specialist, we want to start a new unit. Is there any format for memorandum of understanding?
Memorandum of understanding for what?
Is there any format how we begin the business?
Okay, so how you begin your business? So basically, like, you know, this memorandum of understanding is between you and your partners, or what is the memorandum of understanding about?
Our initial investment and infrastructure and sharing the service.
So it's about your business plan, right?
Yes, it is.
So basically. As we said in the class, the first thing you've got to do is understand whether you have a viable business model, right? So whether the service that you and a team of people are planning to provide is going to make sense from a business standpoint in terms of which customers you're going to address, you know, how you're going to reach them, how you're going to sell to them. What are you going to price that? What are you going to price your service at? What are you going to need to? What services you're going to provide? What services other partnerships like X-ray firms and radiologists and others are going to provide? And then what's going to be the cost? What's going to be the revenue? So we talked about the BMC that you need to prepare. So once you've prepared your BMC, you are going to prepare something called a business plan. And now, over the last 4 weeks, we have been going over different aspects of the business plan that need to be put together, right? So we have talked about product development. We have talked about marketing. Now we are talking about selling. Next week, we'll talk about customer service, customer care. Then we'll talk about negotiations and finance. And then we will kind of put it all together, right? So we are basically talking about how all the aspects or all the elements of your company is going to work together so that you can have a business plan of a good, of a viable medical services company put together, right? So you'll have the finance portion, you'll have the marketing portion, you'll have the customer portion. All of that will be put down in your business plan. And then once you have that business plan, you will then go either to a bank or you'll go to investors and say, this is my business plan, right? So if you're interested, you know, I can provide you some written examples of business plans And you know, why don't I do that? So I will upload some standard business plans, and then you can take your BMC and everything else, write it in the format of a business plan, and that business plan then now can become, you know, your proposal to investors about how they're going to invest. So once they agree to invest, the investors will provide you with something called a term sheet. So the term sheet is maybe the memorandum of understanding that you're talking about. So the term sheet will go ahead and document that, you know, they are willing to put in 1 crore rupees, and you know, they will get preferred stock, and they will get preferred stock for 30% of the company. You guys will have 70% of the company, but on the board of directors, there'll be 2 of their people and 2 of your people. All of that will be there in the term sheet. So the term sheet will be the financial document that will complement the business plan. Okay?
In case of negative interest or dropouts?
In case of failure?
Yes.
Yeah. So basically, when you raise money, you have 2 options. One is to take a risk capital, where essentially the investor is participating in the risk along with the founders, so that if the company fails, then nobody makes any money, but nobody has any legal responsibility to return the money. And in the other case, you take something called debt financing. So when you do debt financing with a bank or some other agency, government agency or something, when you do debt financing, they basically will require you to put up some collateral, so that essentially they can recover maybe not 100% of their investment, but maybe recover 60 or 70% of the investment by taking possession of your collateral and then selling it. Right? So basically, there are 2 kinds of financing. One is debt financing, one is risk capital financing, and you have to decide which one you would rather go for. If you've got very high confidence that your business is going to succeed, then you can take debt financing. When you take debt financing, you basically keep ownership of pretty much all the company. You might have to give a few warrants or something, which is a very small portion of your equity, but you know, when you do risk financing, you will be giving a bigger portion of the equity of your company. So, but you know, you're not liable if the company goes under. So these are all decisions, financing decisions that you will be making, and we will go through the pros and cons of different financing decisions in the last class.
Thank
you. Okay. I'm trying to locate a document. Okay. Okay, so let's go through this case study. Okay, so this is a case study that they use at Harvard Business School, and it's I found it a good case study because it explains some very common problems that people run into. And the important thing is to take everything, all the learnings that we've got over the last 2.5 hours and apply it in order to successfully have the sales meeting. So in this particular case study, there is a company called there's a hospital. So this is the name of the hospital. It's a hospital in Brazil. So we can just call it the hospital in Brazil. And then there is a vendor called Bose Efora, so we'll just call it Bose, that makes a medical device, right? And you know, they've been selling to this hospital their medical device for a long time. For almost 15 years, they've been selling a medical device to this hospital. They have found that since they've been selling this device for a long time, now competitors are beginning to come in and offer the same kind of medical device for 20-30% discount to whatever price they're charging. And these people are finding that the salespeople are finding that it's harder and harder to hold on to the business for this medical device for measuring BP or blood pressure. Because, you know, the competition is beginning to offer it for lower and lower price. But Bose, the medical manufacturer, they found that, you know, if they sell the price, drop the price by 20% in order to compete, then essentially all the profit from that product line disappears, and it's going to be very hard for Bose to stay profitable and viable in the long run. So, and this is a very, very common problem. So, if in the microprocessor business, AMD will always compete with a product that sells for 10, 20% less. If you're in the memory chip business, you know, the Samsung will come in and undercut your prices. If you're in the communication business, Qualcomm gets competition from companies in Taiwan. So there is no place to hide for any company. You will always run into a competitor who's going to compete on price. Today, like in India, almost every business in India is under attack from Chinese companies that offer the same product for 20, 30% cheaper, whether it is, whether it is industrial equipment, whether it's consumer products, whether it is textiles. You know, the Chinese are providing lower and lower cost and fighting and trying to grab market share based on offering a lower price. And lots and lots of companies essentially just don't know how to compete when somebody comes in, competitor comes in and offers a lower price. So same thing is happening here in this particular hospital selling situation. And basically, like, you know, they came up with a solution selling approach where they basically figured out a way to bundle in their blood pressure monitoring equipment with some other functionality. The hospital director is not happy with this particular solution because he's under tremendous budget pressure from his management, and because the economy is weak in Brazil, these BOSI products for automated, easy to use blood pressure cuffs is not something he can live with. And so the salesperson is now caught in a situation where if he's been working with this customer for 15 years and he's worried that, you know, if BOSI cannot handle the discount request, then 15 years of relationship building that he did is going to be wiped out. And so then they have this meeting with the BOSI people, with the hospital people, and the purchasing director Sergio talks about all the hospital's debt and the cannot raise money and the economy and all of that stuff, and it's too expensive. And then the marketing person jumps in and tries to propose many different things, and then Sergio reacts in a negative way to this whole situation. And now it's almost like a make and break case that happens between BOSI and this hospital, because of the fact that, you know, BOSI is not willing to respond to the request of a discount, and the competitor is going to grab more and more of the business. So you can see the nice thing about this particular case study is they have got the personal interactions well described, and you have to now figure out how to prepare for the meeting. You have to figure out how to establish trust before you get into the meeting, then you got to go ahead and do the process for figuring out the customer need, and then you got to figure out which solution, which value selling approach you're going to use. Are you going to do solution selling, consultative selling, value selling? How are you going to talk about interests being more important than price? And then how you're going to do the negotiations between the walkaway prices and so on. And then finally, you're going to do the economic logic. So this is your job this week in order to answer the questions about how you're going to run this sales meeting. You know, this is how most sales meetings are. And, you know, you will typically run into this kind of a sales meeting all the time. So, unfortunately, as you'll see at the bottom of this document, this is something that I licensed from Harvard Business School. So it's authorized for use by Rajan Jaswa only. So please do not download this particular document and save it. Just go ahead and use it online, okay? So that you can answer the questions by reading this stuff online, okay? Unfortunately, this is the way that Harvard Business School works. So, you know, I'm licensed to use this particular paper for teaching only for a 4-month period. And if you want to actually get this paper, you will have to visit this hbr.org and get the paper, and it's going to cost you about $8 or about 250 rupees to get this particular paper. But I personally don't think you need the paper, because, you know, it's what's more important is the story behind this paper, right? And what I liked about this paper is that a lot of the personality of the different people on both sides comes out. The personality of the salesman, personality of the marketing person, and the personality of the sales management on the BOSI side, and the personality of the purchasing guy or the director, Sergio, on the, you know, who's typically a procurement guy on the side of the hospital and who's got his own set of pressures. So go ahead and read this paper online, and then you can answer the questions that I have put in the assignment. So let's see where I put in the assignment. No, this is assignment for next week. Okay. Let's see, the questions are going to be, hang on. Okay, give me a second. I'm just uploading something. Okay, I saw this thing, the big idea audiobook was very good. Do you have other audio? Yes. Okay, while I'm downloading something to discuss which for your assignment, let me share one more thing. I've uploaded another audiobook for all of you guys. This is a must. So I have so I've uploaded this book for all of you guys called Brian Tracy, Change Your Thinking, Change Your Life. These are 8 DVDs or CDs, sorry, and it is priceless to say the least. I think the big idea was awesome because it was very helpful for entrepreneurs to see hundreds of other entrepreneurs creating successful businesses in different ways. But this particular book is about personal development, about how each of you can become better at whatever you're doing, whether it is the job you're doing in your company, whether you're running an organization, or whether you are going ahead and running your own business. And it teaches you systematically kind of the values you need to have and how you can get those values and make them into habits of yours so that you become an indispensable person. You become a great leader in your organization. So this is a fantastic book because ultimately this needs to help you become the best that you can be, but also teaches you how to make everybody around you the best that they can be. See, unless the people around you in your organization are really, really good and keep getting better every day, your company is not going to keep succeeding. So this particular book is all about helping you become the best that you can be at whatever you set your mind to do. And it teaches you the process of doing that. And then since you will now learn how to make yourself the best, you'll also be able to teach everybody around you to become the best, right? So this is, please download this book and go ahead and do it. So let me see right here. Okay, so I'm going to share with you what your assignment is going to be. So essentially, this is going to be your assignment, which is how you're going to go ahead and prepare for this call. Then you're going to talk about how you're going to sell, whether it's solution selling, consultative selling, or value selling. Then how you're going to defend the price, how you're going to, and then this bargaining and all of this we'll do after negotiation. So this particular case study is going to help us bring all of the aspects of what you need to do during your interactions with customers, brings it all together, right? So I'll be updating the assignment with this information, and then you know, you should read the case study online, and then go ahead and do it. Okay, so thank you very much, everybody. If there's any last question, please ask. Or we will again meet next Thursday night in California, Friday in... Okay, what's your question? Yeah, what's the question?
I have a question. I'm Milind from Nagpur.
Yes, Milind.
Are we going to take price discovery in the pricing session separately?
What did you say? Price discovery? What do you mean by price discovery?
What I understand is like many times either the buyer says that this is the sale, this is the price of my product or service, or the buyer says that this is the price at which I'm going to buy. But there is some concept called as price discovery, wherein through what you may say that through consultative selling, the price is arrived at as a systematic process.
Yeah, so that's exactly what you are going to figure out how to do in the negotiations class, which is two classes from now.
Okay.
So when we do negotiations, you will basically, you will have three numbers and the customer will have three numbers on price. The three numbers you'll have on price is your opening price, your target price, your walk price. and the customer is going to have his opening price, his target price, his walk price. And the job of the negotiating process is for you to figure out how to get the customers to come as close to your target price or higher.
Okay.
So we'll do that 2 weeks from now.
Sure. Thanks.
But in the meantime, yeah.
Very interesting class. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Lots of important learnings here, right?
Absolutely. Very interesting. Very, very interesting.
Yeah. You know, business, you know, and that's what makes the startups beautiful, right? Because you get a chance to see all facets of your company building, right? It's like a plant that's growing. You take care of the water, the soil, the air, the heat, the cold, the everything has to be taken care of, and then protected from people stealing your fruit, from animals stealing your fruit, insects destroying everything. So it is, it's a, just like any process of adding value will have challenges, but you know, you can systematically go ahead and you know, counter the challenges and actually build a great company. Okay, thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.